Hello folks, and welcome back to the Keep Productive YouTube channel. Today's feature is going to be a tour, and we are very lucky to have Danny Hatcher on the channel with us. Danny is a Notion pro, but he also runs his own YouTube channel creating Notion videos that range from so many different topics, to code blocks, to subtasks, to things to avoid, things to miss, and even the more advanced stuff like database filters and Excel usage. Anyway, folks, I hope you enjoyed today's feature. A huge thank you to Danny for coming on, and please do make sure you subscribe to both Keep Productive and Danny Hatcher today.
To start off this video, I'm actually going to be on camera. And for those of you that are unfamiliar with me, I'm Danny Hatcher, and on my channel, I speak about Notion, how to use Notion, and different ways that you can manipulate the app, and a couple of other things to work smarter rather than harder, because I believe just because you're busy doesn't necessarily mean that you're actually being productive with your time. In most of the videos on my channel, I'm not actually in the video, as in face-to-face in the video, because I prefer to go straight into Notion and show you what either I figured out, I found out, or some things that I've learned or done along the way. Some of you may have seen some of my live streams where I talk over Notion and go through some other Notion spaces, very similar to what Francesco has done on his channel, which is where you're watching this. But in this video, instead of showing you how to do something on Notion, because there are so many things you could do with the app, I'm actually going to go through my space and how I personally use Notion to do quite a lot of the things daily. I'm not going to go through my whole system because it's an extremely large system with loads of different moving parts and nuanced situations, but I'm going to try and cover as much as I can in the shortest amount of time as possible. So thank you to Francesco for letting me share what I'm doing on Notion with his audience, and let's get into the video. So for those of you that are new to Notion, haven't seen Notion, or aren't as versed in some of the things that you can do with databases inside of Notion, then I would definitely suggest having a look either at my content or some of the other Notion users out there that are sharing content about how to use the app to shape what you're going to do. So what you can see on screen is my dashboard, which is essentially my homepage, my center. It's where everything that I do revolves around. It is the main page that I go to. And as you can see, I have my today tasks. Now, this is my master task database filtered for tasks only specific for today, which in this case was actually the day of recording. Then you can see next to that, I have my inbox. And my inbox, I have a linked database of my notes. So any notes that I need to capture, whether that is a podcast note, article, a blog, or anything that I have used the Notion Clipper for, that is where it will show. Then underneath that, I have a little bit of space where I can just write down some sort of scratch pad type notes. So if anything comes to mind when I'm watching something, doing something, instead of making a note on a piece of paper or on my phone, I actually write that down in my inbox into my dashboard. Now, as I scroll down, I have another view of that master task database that I have linked at the top, but this one's actually only showing the events. So I don't need to see all of the tasks I need to do. I only want to see the events that I'm going to. Now, when I go back up to the top of my dashboard, those of you familiar with Notion will notice that I don't have my sidebar showing. And I personally don't use the sidebar. I've created what I'm going to call a tab bar, very similar to something you have in your Chrome, which is basically an emoji that on the emoji, there is a link to either a page, a database, or a page in a database that's in my space. So this is like my quick links bar. Now I can look at each one of these emojis and I can tell you where all of these emojis are going to take you to, and everyone is going to be individual. So I can say review is the first one, my play page, the dissertation I'm currently working on because I am still a student, YouTube, tasks, projects, exercise, etc. If I bring up my sidebar, you'll be able to see the pages. So you can see I've hidden my private because it's just dashboard in there and I don't need to see that. I have my workspace, which only shows my Notion livestream page, and then my public page, which is Danny Hatcher. So I order those in my favorites bar, mainly because when you use the shortcut Control-1, because I'm on Windows and I'm using the app, it will default to that top favorites page. So I can actually use Control-1 as my keyboard shortcut to get to my dashboard no matter where I am. Now this is my public facing page, so you can find the link to this in all of the description of my videos, and it's on my channel banner on my channel, but in this page you can see the properties, blocks, shortcuts and formulas. They are all guides and explanations of how you could use them and the descriptions of them, with links to all of the templates that I've incorporated those specific things in. And you can duplicate any of those free templates to go straight into your space. If you're not quite sure how something in that template works, I've actually linked all of the properties, the formulas, and the blocks that I've used in the template with the description of those things. So if you're confused about how a formula works in a template, you can click on the relation and that will take you to the formula, and that will explain exactly what the formula is doing. Then I have my Notion livestream page, which is what I use when I'm live streaming to show examples, demonstrations, or try to solve some of the issues that people may have when they're asking in the chat. Now, when I go back to my dashboard, you can see the review page is the first link that I have because I go to review every single day. So you can see I have a flashcards database, and this is very similar to Anki or any sort of flashcard app, and it works very similar. So you can see I have new card. This is just for demonstration purposes. This database is actually full of thousands of cards. Now, when I come in, I can see the card and the question will be on the front of the card, and then I can write the answer down, I can say the answer out loud, and then once I've done that, I can then click on that card because it's a gallery database and the answer will be inside that card. As I scroll down, I have my revision area, and this essentially, for those of you unfamiliar with Notion, this is a database in a list view, and all of these different pages are different areas or sections of my workspace, all of them having their own dashboard essentially inside of them. I will be going into a couple of these areas later on to show you how some of these places work, but for revision purposes, every 10 days the tick box will tick, that's an automatic formula, and then I know I need to go and review that area. Next to my review area I have notes, and this is filtered specifically for the most recently edited notes, so if I have any notes, whether that's a podcast, a YouTube video, books, articles, notes from any meetings or calls, anything that I've recently engaged with, I can see that there. So I can't really forget anything that I've recently done or am currently active with because it's always showing up wherever I go in my space. Now with the flashcards database, I've actually incorporated spaced repetition into it. So for those of you unfamiliar, active recall is really important when you're trying to learn something. So when you actively try and remember the thing, remember the answer to the question, you're more likely to remember it. But as time goes on, you need to be able to recall that as time increases, and that's essentially what spaced repetition is. So in this database, I have a stage, which represents what stage of learning I'm at with this specific question. You can see, because this is a new card, I have all of those templates, so I can attach it to a specific area. And then when I get the card right, I can change the stage to 2. And that will disappear from the view because it's not due today. I don't need to review that card for today. Now, if I get the card wrong, I can change the date wrong day, the review day will change, and then it will disappear from the view if I don't need to review it. This way, when I go in to review anything, if I get it right, I can change the stage. If I get it wrong, I change the date, and the card will reappear at the correct intervals and frequency that I have set inside the formula. I feel like it's important to say that all of the stuff I have in my space you don't need to use databases for, and I have shown in numerous videos on my channel how to build a lot of these things. But you could just simply use a toggle feature and click to open and answer the questions. There are loads of different ways you could do this. So let's go back to my dashboard, and you can see in the calendar I have the event. Now, I've mixed my tasks and events together, so you can see I have the events on my to-do list, so I can see that straight away in the list view, so I don't have to go down to the calendar. Then when I tick them off, as I've done that event, they will disappear from the task view and also disappear from the calendar, because I don't need to think about them because I've done them. As you can see, some of these tasks actually already have the checkbox ticked, and they have the recurring tasks icon next to it. And these are because these are recurring tasks in my space. So they happen daily, weekly, monthly, a specific day of the week, specific day of the month, maybe even specific day of the year. And I don't want them to disappear because then they just won't reappear. So what I do for my recurring tasks is when I've completed it, I then actually put in the date I last did that thing. So I've done my typing for today because I'm trying to increase my typing speed, so I can put the 29th because that's the day I'm recording this, and then it will disappear from today's list, but it will reappear next time it's due, and because it's a daily selection, that will be tomorrow. And like I mentioned, when I was going through that review space area, I review something every day, and that's actually a recurring task in my database, so I can see right here, how many cards I have to review and how many areas I have to review without going into the page. So you can see we've got cards 1 because we had that card that I created. So if I go back to the review space, I don't actually need this card. And if we go to the area, you can see none of those boxes are ticked. So the review is zero. Now, because this card isn't actually a card that I'm going to be using in my space, I'm just going to delete it. But if it wasn't to be showing, then the same thing would happen. And you can see now both of those have disappeared because I don't need to review anything. So I can go into that task, set it as last done for today, and it would disappear from my to-do list. Now, when we go to these other tasks, you can see there's a name that's showing, and that's actually the project the task is related to. So in these cases, if we click in, you can see this is my YouTube area, and this is related to the video I'm creating, Francesco's video, and that is the specific project. Now, because of the way Notion works, I can actually jump straight to that project because it's a related link. So you can see now I'm in the video, Francesco's video. I've got my script, resources, the tasks I need to do for today, all within a couple of clicks. So it was very quick to get there. You can see I've got an automatic progress emoji, which essentially is a traffic light, will go green when I've done something. And I'm related directly to the YouTube area. Now the YouTube area, again, you can see the breadcrumb at the top, I'm in my dashboard, in the review area, in my areas database, and in the review section. So I've jumped about 4 or 5 clicks within 1 or 2. Inside my YouTube space, I have all of the things that I need to think about when creating YouTube videos. So playlist planning, subtasks that are related to all of the videos I create, so standing operating procedure type work. I have notes that I can bring from my dashboard linked database into YouTube. And then I have all of the projects. So these are all of the videos I've got to do, and I've got the progress showing. So if we go to this month, you can see the green dots are ones I've done. They just need to be published. Red dots I'm working on. Red crosses I have not started. Orange, I'm slightly further ahead. And you can see that is all automatic. Then when I scroll down, I have a calendar view of all of the tasks I need to do. So I've set those tasks way into the future, so they will appear when they need to appear, and I don't have to think about I need to do that thing or when I need to do that thing, because it's already set. Now, the process of actually creating a YouTube video is very, very quick and streamlined. So if I click the plus button, it will add a video. Then I can click on my YouTube template, and that will bring up everything I need because it's a preset in the database. I can then drag across all of those preset tasks, drag them down, and now these are all related to the new video that I've made. You can see the name has appeared. The publish has a publishing tag, so when it comes up on my to-do list, I can see that is something I need to publish for today. The roll-up in this video says I have 7 tasks, I have done 0, and the progress is X because I haven't started it yet. Now when I go back into that YouTube area, you can see the video is there. To change the due date of the video, I just need to drag the tile to whatever day I want to publish that video. Then when we go down to the task database, you can see all of those tasks that we dragged into the task database are now showing here in the YouTube area, so I don't have to look at 2 different screens. If I was to change the due date of the video and say it was due later, the tasks are actually going to go down the list because it's sorted by the highest priority task. So if the video is due later on, those tasks need to be done later on in the week. In this specific case, I actually batch my tasks together, as you can see. So I would drag those tasks into the days that I want to do. So all of the scripting tasks would go on Tuesday, research tasks on Monday, and sort them out as I go through. For those published dates, maybe they're 3, 4, even 5 weeks ahead, I can just match the published date of the task with the roll-up of the project. So I can see the video is going to go published on the 6th, so I can just match the due date of the task with the due date of the project, and now everything is set. Now in this specific case, again, this is just a dummy example, so I'm actually just going to delete all of those. But as you can see, when we go back up to that project, because I've deleted the tasks, it's now actually saying that I've completed that project because there are no tasks left to do. But obviously, we know that I've just deleted the tasks, I haven't just ticked them as done. So I'm going to delete it because obviously I'm not going to create a video that says new video. And I'm going to head back to the dashboard space. The process of creating a new note, I could drag it up from that scratch pad into the database, but in most cases, I'll just add in a new note. and then I can pick from those preset templates what sort of note it is. In this case, it's a flashcard note, so maybe I'm watching a podcast, listening to a video or anything like that, and I can write down the notes and create flashcards as I go, and those flashcards will appear in that review space that I showed at the beginning of the video. Now, some days may be really, really productive and I get loads of notes together. Other days, I may not get any notes together. But when I have loads of notes that I need to sort through, I'll actually go to my note-taking space. And what this does is it allows me to filter those notes to the areas that they need to go to. It will then take it out of my dashboard so I don't see every single note in my dashboard, but the note will reappear in the most appropriate place. So I filtered that note for YouTube. It will now reappear in my YouTube space. Then, when I've finished with the note and I've processed that note, I can tick that tick box, and then the note will have been processed. Then, if I needed to go back to see what notes I've recently processed, I can go back to that note-taking space, and there are all of the notes that I've recently processed, just in case I need to go back over them again, or I want to do something else with that note. Now, that is just a couple of examples of how I use Notion to create videos, manage my tasks, and manage my events. And as you can see at the top of my space, there are loads of different quick links that I use to do numerous different things inside of Notion. I'm actually going to be doing a series on my channel very soon where I go in depth and show exactly how I use Notion for every single use case. So if that's something you're interested in, maybe come over to the channel, check it out and see if you can learn something or see if you can be inspired to just use Notion for maybe just collating some information or tracking some habits. And with that, I want to finish off by saying thank you to Francesco, and maybe I'll see you in one of the streams that I host, 7 BST start time, every single Sunday. Be good to see you there.